Hi, I'm Pablo Rossi, and I'm going to present our work on practical and cost-effective verification of delegated computation. Anomorphic cryptosystem allows to compute unencrypted data. For example, if you want the product of two values x and y, and you have a cryptosystem that is homomorphic form multiplication, there is an operation that you can compute on the encrypted versions of x and y, and of which the result, when decrypted, gives you the value of x times y. This mechanism allows to delegate computation to untrusted third parties like cloud providers. A natural question is then, if you need to encrypt your data because you don't trust the third party, why would you trust it with the computation? This question, which started this work, was not new of course, but we found that existing attempts at verifiable delegation of homomorphic computation generally introduce new cryptographic constructions that are specific to a particular cryptosystem, and they also require the collaboration of the interested third party. For example, the work of Lai et al. From 2014, which is the closest to what we want to achieve ourselves, introduced a new cryptographic primitive called Homomorphic Encrypted Authenticator. And more importantly, we found no actual implementation that we could try to play with. What we are trying to achieve is verifying the integrity of a computation that we did not carry out ourselves. Of course, a trivial solution would be to perform the computation ourselves and compare the results. But in this case, we defeat the purpose of delegating the computation in the first place, so the verification has to be inexpensive compared to the original computation. Actually, this same problem exists in another area of cryptography, where it has been solved years ago. Fault injection attacks consist in attacking a cryptosystem implementation by tampering with intermediate values, with the goal of exploiting the incorrect final result to facilitate breaking the cryptosystem. These attacks were discovered and put in practice in 1997 on an optimization of RSA using the Chinese remainder theorem that has to be used in constrained environments such as credit cards. A first countermeasure was proposed in 1999 based on the mathematical principle of modular extension, even if it was not entirely understood that way back then. Indeed, dozens of patents have been filed and accepted that more or less do the very same thing, but in a slightly different way. Since then, it was understood that the essence of these countermeasures was the modular extension principle and that it was not actually tied to RSA modular exponentiation. It was successfully ported to other cryptosystems using elliptic curve cryptography, for example. Indeed, modular extension can be applied to any computation that takes place in a modular structure, such as a field or a ring. To verify a computation that takes place in a finite field of order p, fp, the idea is to generate a random small prime, which we will call our security parameter, r. Then, perform the computation in zpr, the ring of order p times r, instead of in fp. This ring is homomorphic to the direct product of the fields of order p and r, which means that you can get back the result of the computation in fp by reducing modulo p, and the same computation in fr by reducing modulo r. In parallel of this big computation in zpr, perform the same computation in fr. Then, compare the result of this small computation with that of the big one, reduced modulo r. If they match, return the originally expected result with a high confidence that the computation hasn't been tampered with. Otherwise, signal an error. What we did is to realize that even though existing countermeasures using modular extension have all been mixing the big and the small computations in their implementation because they mostly targeted embedded systems, those computations are actually entirely independent and could be carried out on entirely different machines. So our modest contribution was to use this fact to port the modular extension scheme to delegated computation, in particular in the case of homomorphic cryptosystems. We provide a Python implementation of this idea called THC for Trustable Homomorphic Computation that is publicly available from the Python package index. We used THC to perform security and performance analysis of this scheme, and then a demo use case where it would make sense to use it. Our goal with our implementation is to show that the countermeasure is generic, meaning that it is not tied to a particular homomorphic cryptosystem, that it is secure, meaning that you have a really high probability of detecting an integrity violation of delegated computations, that it is cost-effective, meaning that using it won't significantly alter performances, and that it is practical, meaning that it is actually easy to use and requires few code modifications. The THC implementation itself consists of three classes. The main one implements the modular extension scheme, and the two other are interfaces that are used for homomorphic cryptosystems and computation implementation to be used with THC. The first interface requires a cryptosystem to provide encrypt and decrypt functions, of course, but also a method to get the order of the modular structure in which the encrypted values live, and a method to apply a modulus to encrypted values. This last method is useful because not all cryptosystem encrypted values are scalar. For example, L-gamals are pairs. The second interface only requires two methods, one that will perform the computation locally in the small field, and the other to delegate the computation to the entrusted third party and retrieve the results. To make things clear, here is a trivial example without any encryption and an imaginary third party which allows to perform modular computations. We can see that using THC amounts to instancing the THC class with an instance of our homomorphic cryptosystem, which is not a cryptosystem here, and a computation, and of course, our security parameter, here we use 17. Let's actually run this example. Here's the code that we'll execute. Compared to the one on the presentation slides, the computation has the debug output, and the possibility of corruption of the delegated computation is simulated by letting the user alter its result. The remote computation happens in the ring of order P times R, as per the modular extension scheme. Let's let it uncorrupt it first. Here we get the right result, because the result of the remote computation modulo 17 is 1, just like it should. Let's run the same script again, but corrupting the result this time. I'll just put random numbers. THC detected the corruption because the comparison modulo R did not hold. So, the way THC works is not tied to any particular cryptosystem. All that is needed is that the remote computation takes place in a modular structure. That is, any cryptosystem that has its encrypted values in such a structure should be compatible with THC. As examples, we provide implementation of RSA, L-gamal, PAYE, and HE1 in the THC package. Let's actually run a small example with two of these. Textbook RSA is homomorphic for multiplication and PAYE is homomorphic for addition. In both cases, the operation on the encrypted values is a multiplication. We implemented two computations, the second one injects a random fault in the result. Here we have the same code as presented on the slides, and when we run it, we can see that the corruption is detected as expected, and that the same code using THC works with both cryptosystems. So what about the security level provided by THC? First, it is important to know that since we are not introducing a new cryptographic construction, we benefit from years of actual usage in real-world application. The fact that the modular extension scheme has stood the test of time is in itself a convincing argument for its security. But it is still important to know the exact level of security that we can expect from it. It has already been studied formally, in the case of elliptic curve cryptography in particular, and the result is that the probability of not detecting a corruption is inversely proportional to the security parameter, R. This means that choosing a very small value for R will make THC miss corrupted computation. Here is a script similar to the previous one, except that it uses the value 3 for R. As we can see, the corrupted results are not always detected with such a small R. So we claim that the probability of not detecting a corruption is inversely proportional to R. Here is a sketch of the proof. So we call P the delegated computation with XIs, its homomorphically encrypted inputs, and Pbolt the actual remote computation which might have been tampered with. Let N be the order of the modular structure in which we have our encrypted values. Let R be our security parameter, and we call CIs our encrypted values which will be the inputs of the delegated computation. THC will detect an error if the results of P and Pbolt on these encrypted values are not equal modulo R. That is, error will not be detected only if the delegated and the remote computations are equal modulo R, and of course if there is an error. This means that the probability of not detecting a fault is the probability that P minus Pbolt is equal to 0 modulo R, with our CIs as inputs. So we are looking for the number of roots of a polynomial over a finite field, because we make the assumption that the inputs are evenly distributed, which should be the case if we use a reasonable cryptosystem. There is a theorem in the literature which says that random polynomials over a field of order P tend to have, on the average, exactly one root as P increases. So we have two conditions, our polynomial should be random, and the order of our field should be big enough for this theorem to hold. If the remote computation is not corrupted, our polynomial is not random at all as its value is always zero. But otherwise, its constants, like terms and degree, do get randomized by the reduction modulo R, which we recall is itself a random prime. Concerning the order of our field, it is in practice big enough for the number of roots to be very small on average. In their formal study, Dugardin and Guillet found that in the case of the twisted Edward curves, the proportionality constant could be maximum 57 for an error of size 32 bits, for example. Now, a corruption could be the result of a bug or glitch, and in that case we are covered. But what interests us is more the case of not only an untrusted, but also a malicious third party. It is possible in some case for a malicious third party to retrieve the value of R, because it may be necessary to give them the value of n times r in order to apply the modulo reduction as the computation go on to avoid explosion of the size of the result. As r is relatively small, it may be possible for the malicious third party to factorize r out of n times r. Then, of course, the third party could use this knowledge to bypass THT detection. However, they would be limited to adding multiples of r to an encrypted value, which would most likely either result in an invalid value or to a remarkably wrong result once decrypted. Let's go back to our previous example, but this time using our knowledge of R on the remote side to corrupt in a way that will bypass THC verification. We can see that once decrypted, the results do not look at all plausible in this example. In fact, as long as the third party did not break our encryption scheme, it is effectively limited to vandalism. In cases where this might be an actual concern, a solution is delegating the same computation twice with different security parameters. It won't be possible for the third party to tamper with the result of the computation in a consistent way both times, as long as they cannot predict the second value of R while they are corrupting the first computation. So the result will be different. Here is an example of this where we delegate the same computation twice with different values of R. Each time, the third party will use its knowledge of R to bypass THC, but that will result in inconsistent values. Indeed, we can see inconsistent results. Now, if the third party attempts to produce consistent results by corrupting the computation in the same manner twice, it happens that THC will detect the corruptions, since the second time it won't be a multiple of the right value of R that will be added. There. In addition to that theoretical study of the security, we did an experimental study using the four cryptosystems we implemented. We wrote computations adapted to each cryptosystem with remote methods that systematically randomly corrupt their results. Then, we tested each possible combination with different size of the security parameter in order to test our security hypothesis on the probability of non-detection. Here are the results. As we can see, the probability of non-detection is inversely proportional to the security parameter and did drop down to zero in practice when using an R on 32 bits, even after 100,000 attempts. The next question is performance. We wanted to show that the cost of using THC is really small, both in terms of memory usage and of computation time. Concretely, on the client side, we have to keep the value of R on the residues modulo R of each encrypted value that we use in the computation. So memory usage is linear in the number of encrypted inputs of the delegated computation. On the third-party side, the intermediate values and the final result of the computation are bigger, but proportionally not so much. In practice, R will be chosen the size of a machine word, while n is much bigger. Concerning the computation time, on the client side we have to perform the computation in FR instead of nothing, but it is quite cheap as we are not manipulating big numbers here. On the third party side, we are computing in a structure that is a little bigger, so that has a small impact on the computation time too. Note that in most cases, those computations could be performed in parallel, but that we didn't take that into account when measuring the total cost of using THC. As we can see, the additional cost is minimal. It mostly comes from the local computation, which, as we said, could be done in parallel of the delegated computation most of the time. Remark that the additional cost on the third-party side is nearly lesser than the variance induced by the random big numbers. Looking at these results, we could say that using THC is virtually free concerning computation time. So now that we have seen that THC is generic, secure and cost-effective, we still have to see about its usability. We'll do that in the context of a small electronic voting system. Let me stress here that it is not an endorsement of electronic voting, nor is our goal to produce a production-ready voting system. We are only sketching an example of a concrete situation where THC is useful and that allows to demonstrate its usability. So our scenario is that a group of agents who can share a common secret wants to organize a vote. Since the vote has to be secret, they decide to use a third party to organize the vote. But this third party is not trusted. We chose to implement a cumulative voting system in which each agent have a certain number of points that they can freely distribute among the propositions of the vote, as it is the most general of commonly used voting system. Our threat model consists of three conditions. The third party should not be able to know any of the participants' vote, it should not be able to know the result of the vote, and it should not be able to manipulate the vote. We use the Paillet cryptosystem, which is homomorphic for addition, to be able to count the vote, and also a symmetric cryptosystem to protect other participants' data. We call PIs the propositions that are part of the vote. A ballot is a pair with the list of the number of points BI given by a participant to each proposition PI and the ID of the participant. We encrypt the ID using the symmetric cipher and the points with PIE. We call CI the encrypted values of the BI. The third party can be asked to compute the product of all the CIs of a given vote and make that public along with the encrypted identity of the participants to be able to verify that the vote is valid, meaning that the participant did not use more points than they were allowed to. The third party can count the result of the vote by computing the product of all the points given to each proposition, which, once decrypted, will give us the sum. As is, our voting system covers the first 2 points of our threat model, but the third party could still manipulate the vote. We can prevent that using THC. So, if not using THC, we transmit the modulus of our PIE instance to the voting service platform, and of course, each ballot. Then, they use that to count the vote using homomorphic addition, and we can decrypt the result on the client side. To use THC, we generate a random prime R, and we multiply the modulus of our PIE instance by it before sending it to the voting platform. We initialize an instance of THC, of course, and we keep track of the residues modulo R of each ballot on the client side. In practice, that would probably be encrypted using a symmetric cipher and sent to the provider as well, so that everyone can retrieve the residues. Then, on the client side, we can do the small computation over FR, and finally we call THC verify method, which will check the result before returning it if it's okay. In the actual demo implementation that is provided with the THC package, using THC only takes 10 lines of the almost 500 lines of code in the client and requires no change on the server side, which is a bit more than 300 lines. But let's get back to our simpler code and actually run it. So the scenario here is that the group vote on whether they should or should not change their voting platform. At some point, someone in the group finds out that the platform is evil, so they campaign in favor of the yes, they want to change. This makes more people vote and vote for yes. The platform being actually evil, they decide to replace all the ballots that were cast after the campaign with a randomly chosen one from before the campaign. They have no way to know if this will be useful or not, but they hope that there are more votes for no before the campaign than after, so that their manipulation will skew the results in their favor. As we can see, it is the case. Let's run it using THC this time. And again without manipulation, so we can see the correct results. To conclude, we provide an open source implementation of the modular extension idea, which is generic, secure, cost-effective, and usable. With it, we achieved our goal of reducing the necessary trust when delegating computation. However, we did not remove all the need for trust, as THC can only verify the computational aspects of a delegated computation, not the logical aspects. For example, if our voting service provider publishes the vote result in real time as the vote takes place, it could be used to break the secrecy of the vote. As a perspective, we would like to see the idea of THC applied elsewhere, for example, with ChingoLata, which is a compiler that transforms C++ code into encrypted Boolean circuits, that can then be evaluated homomorphically using TFHE, a state-of-the-art fully homomorphic cryptosystem with encrypted values in a modular structure. The logical aspects of the program are already protected in ChingoLata, as it is encoded in the encrypted Boolean circuits. But it could probably benefit from THC to verify the computational aspects of the delegated Boolean circuits evaluation. Thanks for watching.